Today in Matters of Fact, a new government-produced documentary seeks to set the record straight on President Rodrigo Duterte's drug war. Gramo will be aired on PTV and the government's social media accounts. But how will Malacanang's version of the truth compare with that of human rights groups and the brutal realities on the ground? Joining us today is Secretary Martin Andanar of the Presidential Communications Operations Office. Good morning, sir, and thank you for joining us.
Good morning, sir, Christian. Thank you for the opportunity.
Okay, so I understand this documentary will be aired tonight.
Tonight.
It's 1 hour. But basically, what prompted the PCOO to come out with this documentary after 3 years?
Yeah, so 3 years has gone, and what we wanted to do is to update the citizens. Also the international community of the strides, the accomplishments of the drug war. Secondly, is to be able to show the public and the international community the realities on the ground, the challenges that we are having. And thirdly, is to be able to impress the rationale of the president, which is basically to save the future of a nation by countering hard drugs.
So what basically are the realities that you want to show here in this documentary?
It's all there. All of the issues that have been thrown against the administration.
Like what?
For example, human rights. It's in the documentary. The police scalawags, how the government is countering, how the government is, what the government is doing against these police scalawags. There are also the numbers, the real numbers. We also have true to life case studies that we included in the documentary. So it's a 50-minute plus documentary. It's all there, everything from June 30 to today. All of the facts are there. And this is the government's take on the war on
But is this the real situation?
Yes, it is the real situation. We have the PIDEA, we have the DILG, we also have the situation thrown at us. We also have the case of Kian De Los Santos, the 17-year-old teenager that was killed in Caloocan, and what the government did.
But what exactly would you like to set straight here?
The reality.
What do you think, for example, is the most unfair portrayal of the drug war, which somehow prompted the PCOO to come out with this documentary?
The extrajudicial killing, that issue that has been thrown at the administration since 2016. So by showing all of the facts here in this documentary, then we are hoping for an appreciation of what is really happening on the ground. And of course, it is a very important, Christian, to inform the public where we are taking this for the next 3 years.
But what
for the latter part, yeah.
What does the documentary say when it comes to extrajudicial killings? There are no EJKs?
The documentary is saying that EJK is not a government policy.
But they happen.
It EJK, depending on depending on what case you're looking at. So for example, you are looking at the internecine of drug lords where they kill themselves for territory. Then that's EJK from their end, right? But if you're asking if EJK is a national policy, it's a government policy, never been a policy of national government.
But why would you even, for example, assuming that there was indeed a policy, quote unquote, why would the documentary say that there's such a thing? Of course not, diba?
Oh, no, of course not. Well, because that's the issue that's been thrown at us internationally.
But I think the problem here being pointed out by a lot of the victims, the relatives, and human rights groups is that the president's pronouncements and the policies that he instituted set the atmosphere under which these things happened.
But contrary to that, I would argue that because of the war against hard drugs, criminality has gone down, crime volume has gone down. Actually, it's here in this magazine that we published. The treatment of drug abusers have gone up. The number of barangays that were cleared of drugs have also gone up. That's more than 15,000. We are still targeting another 17,000 barangays to clear. Plus the fact that fewer families say that they are victimized by common crimes, 5.6%, okay. A drop of 7%. So all the indicators would show that the war against criminality, the war against hard drugs, have been very positive to our communities.
Okay, fair enough, because we know that there are accomplishments for more than 3 years since the president launched his drug war. Mm. But what does the documentary say about the vigilante-style killings? Mask assailants riding in motorcycles, because there is there are a lot of suspicion that some of them, if not most of them, were perpetrated by policemen themselves.
You know, that's a very good question, because according to the numbers that were given by our critics, they say 27,000 that have died, but that's really a generalization and a very unfair argument from them that it's all about drug war. 27,000, this is the entire homicide cases that were recorded by the Philippine National Police.
But what's your figure when it comes to those who were killed by motorcycle riding men? Vigilante style killings.
I don't have the number of the motorcycle or the riding in tandem style of assassinations, but what I can tell you is that the numbers of the numbers that were killed because of the drug war is about 5,700 to 6,000.
That is the official figure.
Yeah, that's the official figure, not the 20s. But you know, it's very important for us to talk about, because we're talking about riding in tandem, etc., which basically hit its peak during the last administration. But if you check at the numbers, which are here, homicide and murder incidents from 2016, from 12,228 has gone down to 8,933 for 2018. Crime solution efficiency from 57% in 2016. Crime solution efficiency has gone up to 74.42% in 2018. Improved case disposition. You will see that from 2016, the disposition rate was 87%. In 2018, it's already 89% case disposition. Court disposition. So in courts, you will see that the conviction rate in 2016 was 22%. In 2018, it's 41.68%. So all of the numbers are looking up in terms of solving cases, of homicide cases, murder cases, and even the justice system.
But how about those who were killed in relation to illegal drugs? I think that is one of the biggest concerns. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. What exactly has the government done?
It's also here.
Because we're not getting any somehow credible figures from the Philippine National Police. Usually they would just say these cases are being attended to, but how many were convicted? How many cases were filed, for example?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Well, okay. So, for instance, here, the conviction rates of illegal drug cases. You will see that from 2016, cases with conviction rate was only 1,138. In 2018, it rose to 77,000.
You're referring to drug users and pushers?
Conviction rate, yeah.
Okay.
Conviction rate of illegal drug cases.
I'm actually referring to those who were killed in relation to the campaign against illegal drugs.
They are.
And the, let's say, policemen who were involved in, let's say, summary execution of suspects during
police operations. An example, yeah, that's good question. An example would be the Key and the Los Santos case.
But that's one case.
Three policemen. I mean, that's basically the mother of all cases.
Oh, pero there's no debate regarding that.
Yeah.
Good thing that they were convicted, the three policemen, but how about the other cases?
There are more than 400 policemen that were already fired from the service because of cases that involved illegal drugs.
But how many were convicted because they killed suspects who were actually supposedly nanlaban, but actually did not put up a fight?
Yes, yes. It's a good question. With that specific question and the details, I don't have the details with me right now, but what I'm saying is that more than 400 of these cases have resulted to the firing of more than 400 policemen.
But does the documentary address that issue squarely?
It's there, and you will watch it tonight.
As in, for example, yeah. What exactly happened to the cases the cases of killings in connection to illegal drug anti-drug
yes.
operations?
It's being addressed in the as I said, the documentary would have the side of the government, would also have the questions of the critics, and it will be answered in that documentary, 50 minutes.
In the first place, why the need to come out with this documentary? Do you feel that you're losing the propaganda war?
We feel, well, it's not that we feel, but we believe that it is the mandate of the Presidential Communications Operations Office to communicate the message of government and to communicate the side of the government, the narrative of the government.
That's our job. But why only now?
No, we've been doing that for the last, different forms. Say, for instance, we came up with an advertisement that was directed by Brillante Mendoza. We also had numerous journals that we released. Now we have the campaign called Real Numbers to challenge the fake numbers that were coming out during those times. We have Riabina. So we have all sorts of programs. But the documentary that we have now is the first time we're and it's one form. It's just one form of communication, and we'll have more.
Who is the main intended audience of this documentary?
Two audiences, the Filipino citizens and the international community. In fact, we will have a special screening for members of the diplomatic community here in the Philippines.
So it's in English or Filipino?
It's in Tagalog. It's in Filipino, but the version that we will show the international community is dubbed into English, and there's also a subtitle.
Isn't this just a way to somehow deodorize a brutal drug war?
No. It's essentially our job to tell the story of government. I mean, it can never be just one-sided. You have to hear the story of government. Whatever the president says on television, on the newspaper, online, internet, all his arguments are here in this documentary.
So what is the main? What is the main point of the documentary when it comes to those who were killed by assailants riding in tandem?
Well, you asked that earlier.
Then, ano exactly yung ano? What is the version of the government there? These cases or incidents were the handiwork of drug syndicates fighting among themselves.
Yeah. It's difficult to point out which case is which, but we focused on the case of Kian de los Santos, which we know that it was a case of kidnapping the person, getting him from the house, which was shown on CCTV, and executing him.
Okay, I'm asking about the vigilante style killings because we know that there seem to be two categories in the conduct of the drug war. Mm. One, the group of suspects killed during police operations, and that in itself raises a lot of questions because allegedly policemen are very trigger happy. That's one side. The other side is, what exactly is the government doing when it comes to those vigilante-style killings? Because you know for a fact that that is also the responsibility of the government to address those issues.
Number one,
killings should not be happening.
Yeah, those killings should not be happening. We do not condone those types we do not condone killing for that matter. What we are doing here is the Philippine National Police are still running after people who are killing people. It's the natural to serve and protect the people.
But what are the results? It's been more than 3 years.
I will show you the conviction rates as I showed you earlier.
Specific dun sa vigilante style killings.
Yeah, I can give you the details.
Is that in the documentary?
What is in the documentary is the Kian de los Santos.
Inga, why focus only on the Kian de los Santos?
Because he is
killing?
The face of this. It is the case that's been focused. It is the case that's been thrown at the government since that happened until now. So what we're doing is we're showing the public what the government did to the three policemen that were the suspects and now already convicted.
Okay. Now you mentioned the figure. I think the Philippine National Police figure, when it comes to the suspects killed during police operations, at least 5,500 from July 1, 2016 to June 30, 2019. So, in sa figure siya, nadagdaga na, diba? So, siguro nasa 5,700?
5,700, 5,800, yeah.
But do you think that's worth it?
What's worth it?
5,700 suspects killed.
Okay.
In 3 years.
There are more than, as mentioned by the president, 6 to 7 million addicts in the country. And out of these addicts, 1.5 million have already surrendered, and 480,000 plus, 480,000 plus have already submitted themselves for rehabilitation voluntarily.
How many again?
480,000 plus
volunteered to be rehabilitated. Yeah,
and they are rehabilitated. Now, if you, the argument is always human rights, right? Human rights. So you have the human rights of these 480,000 to 490,000 rehabilitated drug users, and the 7 million drug users. The president always argues if the father becomes addicted, then you have a dysfunctional family already. Kasi what will the mother do? The money that was supposed to be for food is now being bought, used to buy drugs. And if you look at the 5,700 compared to the number of people that have actually benefited, everybody this in the studio, people who go home to ungated communities, lahat na ikinabang dyan. So this is a war on hard drugs that is to save the future of a nation. Now, if you do not do it, then this country will just be a basket case.
But what does the documentary say when it comes to human rights violations that have been identified? I won't say alleged anymore, because you know that these things are happening. You have the accounts coming from the relatives. Of course, they would say na hindi naman ang laban eh, but they were killed. Now, of course, the police version would be, of course, it was in the course of official duty.
Yeah, it's what the police says and it's what the police says and what the families of the victims say. Now, the accounts of the policemen is that they have an official raid with an authorized raid with approval of the courts, and when they were in the process of accosting the person who was pushing drugs, and unfortunately, nanlaban, may dalang bala, may dalang baril, and that is the story. And the story of the victim is naturally would say, no, hindi totoo yan. But the facts are there that there is drugs at may baril yung biktima at lumaban sa police.
You yourself are convinced that those 5,700 suspects or people all put up a fight? That's why they were killed?
I would say that it is part of the authorized police operations. Of course, I cannot say conclusively that each and every case is like this and like that. He may not conclude.
But when you look at the numbers somehow, are you convinced?
I am convinced by the reasoning of the policeman.
Okay. Now, before I let you go, let's move to another topic. The president's...
can I just plug before you ask that question?
Okay, sige. Mamaya.
Later. Okay.
Go.
Oh, 7 p.m. 7 p.m. tonight. The documentary is called Gramo. It will be shown on your government channel, PTV, and will be streaming live on all the PCOO-managed Facebook accounts.
And you also have a magazine, right?
We have a magazine. This is the Saving the Future of a Nation, Countering Hard Drugs. This will be given to the media. It was already given yesterday, and will also be distributed to the international community.
Okay. Before I let you go, one last point regarding the president's actions and pronouncements against the two water concessioners in Metro Manila. Number one, the fear is that, is he just trying to replace those two so-called oligarchs with an oligarch of his own?
Oh, no, definitely not. The main point here is that we should not be entering into onerous contracts. This is, in fact, doing the business community a favor by telling them that there is no room for corruption in our business industry. And under the term of President Rodrigo Roa Duterte, and there are no sacred cows. You've been asking for big fish, and there you go.
Because I've been hearing certain names, for example. This was also addressed previously, the past few days, that the billiards might actually be coming in. That's why the two other water concessioners are being
I don't think so. I think that would... I think the purpose here is to send the message to both Maynilad and Manila Water that the president is not accepting this kind of reasoning and this kind of onerous contract. And that's why the MWSS revoked the extension of the contract, and both both Manila Water and Maynilad already wrote a letter to the president, which will be read by Sal Panelo later.
Okay, Secretary Martin Andanar.
Thank you
very much for joining us. Thank you for watching. Now, for more videos, subscribe to the official ANC YouTube channel and click the I button.